Hello and welcome to the Space News Commercial Space Transformers series, where we aim to give you a behind-the-scenes look at the people and companies driving the space industry's commercial transformation. I'm Jason Rainbow, Senior Staff Writer at Space News, and today I'll be talking to Mike Greenley, CEO of MDA Space, which builds satellites, operates the radar site imaging constellation, and specializes in space robotic arms. The company has traditionally played a backseat role in non-geostationary orbit, providing antennas and other satellite components, but all that changed in 2020 after being carved out of Maxar Technologies as an independent company. The deal enabled MDA to invest in mass manufacturing facilities and a software-defined satellite platform that has put it on course to become a leading constellation prime. So, Mike, it's a pleasure to have you here with me in your technology manufacturing perspective to discuss the commercial evolution taking place across the space sector and where it might be heading. Are you ready for me to throw all kinds of questions your way about this?
Sure, bring them on.
Good stuff. Excellent. So MDA is well known for its iconic space contributions like the Canadarm and its involvement in assembling the International Space Station. How are you leveraging this legacy of robotics and space infrastructure to expand into satellite manufacturing and non-geostationary constellations?
Yeah, I think that our experience in manufacturing continues to advance in all fronts. You're right that our history includes the manufacturing of complex robotic systems for the space shuttle and the space station. We've got involved a lot with robotics, though, in the manufacturing of satellites in the last several years. The satellite teams have gotten involved in low Earth orbit constellation development. And as a result of that, we're on our fourth or fifth constellation now that we've supported. We started at this component or subsystem level, and that work has caused us to move from a few satellites to dozens of satellites to hundreds of satellites. With the OneWeb constellation, we ended up delivering antennas for 600 satellites or more. That was over 2,000 antenna units that we had to deliver in terms of production units and spares. And that really caused us to have a peak in volume manufacturing and production, both in the areas which caused us to advance ourselves in the areas of additive manufacturing, more 3D printing, massive reduction in the number of parts, and in advanced manufacturing, increased use of robotics for both assembly and test. Now, the robotics we use for manufacturing is not the same as the robotics we use for space or on-orbit manufacturing. That's a different kind of class of robotics. The space robotics that we develop and operate are much more complex than the robotics that we use in advanced manufacturing and satellite systems. But that's caused us to be able to now produce at scale and volume, so that now we're actually putting on a manufacturing addition to our satellite business area that will double our output. As we enter 2026, we'll be in a position to produce two satellites a day in terms of a production rate, which is the highest in the world for our class of satellites. That's all of that technology and capability for advanced manufacturing we leverage on all of our satellite manufacturing, even if it's a smaller volume, so that we can produce more efficiently. So in our geointelligence business, to answer your question there, when we get contracts for new Earth observation satellites or new space observation satellites, we're leveraging all these advanced manufacturing techniques that we've established on the higher volume, low Earth orbit and mid-Earth orbit constellations.
Good stuff. Well, so with the space industry seeing more partnerships and collaborations and cooperation, which is always weird to say, how does MDA balance its relationships as both a supplier to existing mega constellations and a potential competitor in the prime contractor space?
It's always been that way, really, in space. I agree that that the terms that you're using about coopetition is a very common dynamic that we have. From MDA's position, we've got over 50 years experience delivering satellite subsystems to satellite manufacturers, and we have a strong relationship there. Even the large satellite manufacturers that have their own internal departments, they might have their own internal antenna department or bus department or electronics department. And on simpler satellites, they'll often just use their own internal capacity. We have found when it gets hard, when it gets complicated, when we're pushing the boundaries of technology, they will often come to MDA Space, and then we'll get the opportunity to deliver them their technology for their harder challenges in our production facility, engineering and production facilities. And so people appreciate that. We try to be a good performer. We've gotten a lot of awards, even from these large satellite manufacturers that we do compete with, as the, you know, the most reliable supplier award, for example, on OneWeb, and, you know, gold supplier awards for other large satellite manufacturers. And that's a great place to be. And then we do show up and compete against each other. They seem to be treated as separate topics. You can be a good supplier, and then some days you can be a good competitor as well at the same time. So we all seem to get along just fine as a result.
What really struck me when I came to this event was the energy that was in that room when we first got here, and the engagement that was across the room, a diverse set of companies that are here today and capabilities that we're all bringing to the market. It's pretty amazing.
Talking about things that are getting hard and things that get complicated, what challenges have you faced in transitioning from being just a subcontractor to taking a leading role in satellite manufacturing, and how have you addressed them as you ramp up?
Yeah, the biggest things I think for us in the satellite manufacturing and that ramp up phrase is that we are taking a satellite prime role in constellation work. So we're not just producing a satellite, which we've always done for Earth observation or space observation. We've done that for years. But now to produce largely communication satellites at volume is the new challenge. The key activities that cause change, I think, are in procurement especially. Mm-hmm. So you're now producing at volume. Your assessment of your suppliers is not just, do they have good quality and a decent price, but also, can they scale with you? So, we've seen this happen now with our procurement on our MDA Aurora product. Our first two customers there is the Telesat Lightspeed constellation for 200 satellites, and this unnamed customer that we have right now for another constellation, which is at least 36 satellites. So, you know, with spares, you're out procuring, let's say, for 240, 250 satellites. And that's really interesting volume. The satellite industry isn't used to that. And we have a very busy pipeline of additional future constellations. You know, as we create a manufacturing capability to produce two satellites a day, we could get up to some sustained production rates over multiple years in the hundreds of satellites. And so you want suppliers and partners that can scale with you and that are still going to be able to invest in their roadmaps so that our overall satellite roadmap can be supported as version 1, 2, and 3 of MDA Aurora evolve over the next few years. And so the relationship with the suppliers is increasingly important, and the assessment of them in terms of their ability to scale is increasingly important.
Right. And procurement and the ability of suppliers to scale along with you was no easy task during the pandemic. We saw all the time companies running into supply chain issues. Are we out of the woods there now in terms of the difficulties the broader supply chain in space had to deal with?
I think so. To be honest, we found as a company that in space, the supply chain issues weren't actually as bad as the broader consumer sectors. Mm-hmm. Space technology tends to be a bit more niche. As a result, the volumes are lower. You know, when we're out working on computer chips or the like, we're not competing for the same chips that are used in all the automotive and all the vehicle manufacturing or consumer electronics and you know, being purchased in the hundreds of thousands to millions of, you know, objects. We're in a, you know, high performing, you know, space hardened technology where, you know, now we're procuring hundreds, but, you know, the market itself is not. And so we found that some of our lead times got longer during the pandemic, and that's lingered a bit. And so we had to be able to increase the number of long lead items on our project deliveries. Other than that, we've done pretty well as a space community, we feel, ensuring sources of supply, just making sure that we've given a bit more time to those that need a bit more time to be able to deliver.
Good stuff. Glad to hear it. Of course, many space companies are laser focused on reducing costs while improving satellite capabilities. It's an industry-wide trend. Yep. What steps is MDA taking to ensure competitiveness in what is an increasingly crowded market?
Yep, I think that on the the cost reduction side, the additive manufacturing mindset is definitely kicking into gear now. So using more 3D printing, you know, reducing the number of parts, advanced techniques to manufacture elements, the advanced manufacturing assembly. So we're using automation where it makes sense. We found in a couple of areas, we over automated, and it actually made more sense to keep certain tasks human, completed by workers as opposed to by robots. And so finding that balance of efficiency in terms of efficiency and craftsmanship, in terms of where does it make sense to keep it a human task and where can we automate the task, is a constant learning. But it is constantly improving to be able to have the most efficient production cycle and highest quality production cycle that we can. Certainly the shift to volume gives you economies of scale. So your purchasing power increases, your prices will go down as you're buying more. And then we have had a strong, strong drive in both satellites and robotics in productization. And so we are, you know, working towards a common product in MDA Aurora for our digital satellite. And we're working towards a common product in MDA SkyMaker, our commercial line of space robotics. And we're bringing our customers to our standard product. The history in the space industry has been that the purchasing customer often has an engineering department. You know, even if you're operating a network for communications and you're going to buy your satellites, you're going to have an engineering department that has a strong opinion about the design of the satellites that they're going to operate and the resulting communication network capability. And so often on each project, you would bring the two engineering worlds together, the world of the operator of the constellation and the world of the satellite manufacturer. And they would come together and fine-tune the spec and the design. And there would be a extended non-recurring engineering phase there as everybody kind of aligned on what we're all really going to do here. As we come to a standard product more, it's like there's the standard product. And then you're bringing that to the constellation. And we're finding the constellation engineering teams are willing to shift. They're willing to adapt and adopt more of a standard product so that they can get the economies of scale of us selling similar products to multiple customers, which decreases schedule time and decreases cost.
Right. And then maybe talking about products and services that might be a little further out. It's still early days, but there is growing interest in in-orbit satellite servicing and assembly. Is MDA exploring the intersection of your heritage and space robotics with emerging trends like satellite life extension or orbital debris management?
Yeah, absolutely we are. Well over a decade ago, we had actually gotten to a full solution, spacecraft with proximity operation sensors and robotic solutions to do on-orbit servicing. We'd spent tens of millions of dollars, in some cases of funded dollars, funded money from customers to study on-orbit refueling of unprepared satellites that had not been prepared or built to be refueled. A lot of effort was spent into that. So the company was actually well before my time, ready to go with solutions in that regard, but decided not to, that they were ahead of the market. As that market matures and becomes real now, we have, you know, great thinking and great solutions in that regard. Certainly with our commercial line of robotics, we have customers in our pipeline that are interested in on-orbit servicing and customers in our pipeline interested in active debris removal in addition to on-orbit manufacturing. And so those customers are looking for solid proven robotics technologies that our standard product can offer them for their solutions. In addition, as a company, we now have a full vertically integrated spacecraft design and assembly capability in our satellite business. And certainly we could put our proximity operation sensors and our robotics from our robotics business on the spacecraft from our spacecraft business. And you would have some interesting servicing solutions there that could come from MDA Space. And so we are very open to those conversations in the market.
Very good. What are some of the other exciting innovations or projects that MDA is currently working on that you believe will significantly impact the future of the space industry?
I think that on the satellite side, we've said the words digital satellite, but you know, our MDA Aurora digital satellite product and its roadmap for the future, I think, is a key innovation area in terms of you know, constantly increasing the performance of a satellite, the ability to use dynamic beam forming to adjust the performance of a satellite in real time, and be able to do that with, you know, lower mass, higher performance. So the evolution of that satellite product roadmap is going to be an important feature of the space industry for bringing down the cost and increasing the performance of constellations. So that's one. On robotics, the design of the robotics is becoming standard. It becomes more affordable. We're putting a fair amount of effort into the operation systems for robotics. In our extension of Canadarm2 robotics work, we got a $250 million order in Q1 for the last 5 years of ISS operations. In that, our scope has been increased to now include operations to become certified, NASA certified operators of the robotics on the ISS. On our Canadarm3 contract, we will have a responsibility for operations of those robotics on Gateway. We have established new mission control centers for that in our facilities in Toronto, in Canada. And we've also included commercial operation centers as well. So in our relationship with commercial space stations, we want to offer them the robotics and their operations moving forward. The operational systems is becoming more artificial intelligence based. So they're becoming more automated and have more autonomy to be able to do tasks as well as we go forward into the future. So the whole operational technology roadmap for robotics in space is increasing. And the application areas is increasing as we also now take those to rovers. We have at least a couple of rover projects where we're now bringing the robotics to the rovers as, you know, different types of utility vehicles, for example, for the moon. And so that will, that drives innovation there. In the geointelligence space, we're really starting, we're introducing, multiple satellite constellations now with CHORUS. So having tipping and queuing between satellites so that we have a broad area surveillance satellite in the lead, you know, capable of 500, 700 kilometer swaths of the Earth in its imaging, and then a very, very narrow zoomed in satellite that is an hour and a half behind. So we can detect things and then zoom in the same orbital loop. And so that's a new commercial capability globally that advances the marketplace, which is very cool. And on CHORUS, we're also introducing some onboard processing, some vessel detection onboard processing, so that we can start to do pilot testing with customers of the, instead of sending down the raw data, for example, and processing that and doing ship detection in the oceans, we'll just do the ship detection onboard the satellite and send the ship contact information down. And so that's an important evolution as we take more of the processing capacity for space operations to the satellite. That's a key evolution that we're working through as well at the moment.
So just a few things.
Yes, a few things. Sorry for talking.
Wonderful. Brilliant. Thank you for that. And just on the software-defined satellite side of things, you know, you mentioned a mystery customer. How long do you think that customer will remain a mystery? And when could we hear the next, when can we learn about the next constellation customer for you?
Yeah, we think the unnamed customer will be sorted out in 2024. It looks like that's the case. We're doing fine. Like, we just keep getting our work done on the project using the authorizations to proceed we've been funded for. They have some work to do that they would like to do as a customer on the configuration of their business before they announce what they're up to. And so, and then as a result of that, sign our full contract. And it looks like they're definitely working to do that this year. So I think that will come out. We have a busy pipeline there as well. So we would hope to, over the next year, you know, hope to see ourselves sign up, you know, one or two other constellations. That seems possible.
Good stuff. I'll keep a lookout. Mike, thank you so much. Always a pleasure to speak with you. Thank you again for taking the time to talk with me today.
No problem. Anytime. Happy to tell the stories of MDA Space.